not your jam?
I couldn't get into it. I watched a couple episodes and I just, there was some where I was like, ha, but then it wasn't like a follow up with a ha ha ha.
Not, it was just a singular ha.
Pretty much. It was a singular ha.
But not ha ha.
No, I couldn't get the rest of it out.
All right, that's fair.
Yeah.
Because it just made that stupid Borat thing. There was an episode where they were trying to like get this guy back, and so they like hired him to do at the end of the show they hired him to do like an impersonator thing, and so he or like a stripper dance thing, and then he's like, "You want to see my Borat?" And he goes, "It's my wife, very nice." It was just like real bad, and he was in like that weird thong thing. That was it.
Was he doing the finger guns too?
Of course.
Hell yeah.
You have to.
You have to finger gun in the finger thong.
Finger thong. Guess it's like maybe the width of a finger.
Yeah. What do you even call those?
I think it's called a mankini.
A mankini.
Yes.
Interesting.
I could be wrong on that, but I think I'm right.
Okay. I'll go with it. I just call it the Borat swimsuit.
And it's pretty much what it is.
Yeah.
I don't think anybody has ever
called it a mankini.
Well, I don't know if anyone's ever worn that. Like
besides him.
Before that existed. Because that is a very aggressive swim attire.
Yeah, and very loud. Yeah. It was very loud.
Is it because he's very hairy or just because it's neon green?
I think it's a combination of both. Just the color and the fur. It's just, it's, yeah.
I love Sacha Baron Cohen. It's like it's not okay how much I enjoy him.
I mean, I liked it too, but you really liked the second Borat.
Yeah, I thought it was funny.
Yeah.
It was uncomfortable.
Yeah, oh, extremely.
I was trying to convince one of my clients to watch it, and he's like, "Is it anything like the first one?" I'm like, "Well, yes, but also no."
It's worse, and by way worse, I mean way better.
It can arguably be considered a little bit worse. Because I was trying to explain the debutante ball thing.
Yeah.
Which, as an aside, when that movie first came out, the second one.
Yeah.
That was also the first time I learned what a debutante ball was. So
really?
Fun times. Yeah, why would I ever? That's what Marissa said. Oh. She's like, "How do you not know what this is?" I'm like, "Why would I know what it is?" Oh, I'm not like a.
You're not
I
from did, the South, so that makes
I'm
sense.
Not from the South. Yeah. I didn't grow up like rich and affluent.
On a cotton farm.
And also, I'm like, I feel like that's more of like a female based thing.
Is it?
Probably not. But that's what like that my perception of it was.
Oh, okay.
Like it seemed like more of that type of thing, though. Gotcha. I guess boys are a part of it too. So yeah. Whatever.
I gotta dance with somebody.
That's true.
I wanna dance with somebody.
So, but I was like, why would I?
Why would
I know that?
That's fair. I guess I only know about it because I watched a lot of like Western and Southern films or like old Western films, and they had balls or debutante balls. And
all right.
That's how I know. I don't really, I didn't follow up with it and try to figure out what the
hell. You didn't try to go to one?
I feel like if I had attempted to go to one, it probably would have been escorted into the back door. And either never seen again or working as the help staff.
As the help.
Yeah.
Oh, God damn it. what was the key, the Jordan Peele movie?
Get Out?
Yeah. You'd get outed.
I would get outed. Yeah. For sure.
I mean, they don't seem like they're inherently racist.
I would say now they don't seem that way. But when I learned about it back in the 90s, still felt like it.
I mean, well, you just said you were watching like old Westerns. So you were watching movies
Which
from like
great
the 50s and the 60s.
Which is a great portrayal of how it used to be.
Used to be is the key word.
Okay.
Look, unless you're going to like rural like Mobile, Alabama.
Or Mississippi.
Or like random mass Mississippi.
Yeah. Where else would they have debutante balls?
It feels like Texas. Didn't they do that one in Texas?
No, I think that was Georgia.
All right. So, yeah. I mean.
Yeah.
Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, mm-hmm. maybe Louisiana.
Actually, yeah, I think
so. I could maybe see maybe like a Kentucky, Tennessee type of thing.
Yeah. No. I won't shit on Tennessee. I'm welcomed in Tennessee. It's safe for me to walk down the street.
Generally speaking. Generally yes. speaking. I feel like what's it, Beale Street? Is that no. That's Memphis. Memphis?
What?
Beale Street? Where's that at? I can't remember. I don't remember if that's Memphis or Nashville. It's not
no,
Nashville
is oh shit, my cousin's down there right now. Oh god.
It's fine. Yeah. I won't know.
I love that street is awesome. It's like Tennessee's version of Vegas.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think it's Beale Street in
Nashville's version
in
of Vegas,
Memphis.
Sorry.
And that I feel like that's one of those streets where it's like an equal or like not that street, but like just in that area. I was like, it feels like an equal opportunity.
I feel like all of Nashville is.
You're about to get beat up.
You where? In Memphis?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, I haven't been to Memphis. I would like to go to Memphis. Memphis, Knoxville. What's the other one?
What is there in Knoxville?
I don't know. Whiskey?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Why not, right?
Wouldn't you want to go to like Lexington? Isn't that where?
Lexington, Kentucky?
Yeah.
Didn't we just finish talking about how it's probably not.
But that's where whiskey is.
It's also in Tennessee. JD, baby. Founded in Tennessee.
Jack Daniels?
Mm-hmm.
No one drinks Jack Daniels.
What?
Jack Daniels is trash.
Okay, yeah, as a sipping whiskey, but as a mixer, it's probably one of the greatest mixers alive.
Hold on.
Huh.
So, hey, Eric, here's a drink that tastes terrible for you to drink on its own. But when you cover it up, it's better.
Right.
So it's terrible.
No, Jack and Coke is delicious.
No, it's terrible.
No, it's not.
Jack Daniels and Coke is terrible.
Jack Daniels and Coke
you
is
get
not terrible.
You get a better whiskey and mix it with Coke, and then it's better.
You could literally say that about any alcoholic beverage.
You're 100% correct, and that's why I have a fucking highbrow. That's why I'm so highbrow with my booze. Why would you drink a shitty tasting whiskey to just try and cover it up with something else while still having the remnants of like the aftertaste of shitty
whiskey? What would you mix with Coke?
Nothing, because I don't drink that.
Okay, so
normally I don't drink that. I'm a hypocrite because I drank it tonight. But I do when I. But so when I, my mixing drinks.
Yes. What are your mixing drinks?
I generally drink gin and soda.
Okay, that's what I drink when I go out. Fucking boring. So
I like the flavor of gin.
You like the flavor of
specifically
of like canned ice spray can lemon water, lemon lime water.
Specifically, Old Tom gin. Mm-hmm. If we're gonna play this game here.
Gin's trash.
That's fine. You're welcome to think that. I like the taste. I like juniper. And Old Tom gin is a little bit sweeter. And some of them have a little bit more of like other flavors that you're like botanicals that are thrown into it too.
Oh, you had to use a big word like botanicals.
I did because it's a highbrow drink. It's a classy ass
drink.
Look
at your eyebrows. They're highbrows.
I do have some highbrows. You're just describing me at this point. I'm just going to agree with you.
Yeah.
Classy people drink gin.
Name one classy person besides yourself that drinks gin. And don't say Ryan Reynolds.
Ryan Reynolds has a gin company.
That's why I said don't say Ryan Reynolds.
Why?
Because
you already know?
Yeah.
And you like Ryan Reynolds?
I love Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah,
I
know.
God damn it. Besides Ryan Reynolds.
I was going to say 007, but he drinks the vodka martini.
That's right. Shaken, not stirred.
Gin martini is actually pretty good, too. Vodka's trash. Vodka is what 17-year-olds drink.
I think we can agree. Well, I don't know, man. At 17, I was drinking Jaeger.
Well, that's because it was popular, because of Jaeger bombs.
That's true, yeah. No, but I think
fucking Jaeger bombs.
Jaeger bombs. Jaeger bombs.
Mom, give me some more goddamn protein.
I think we can agree. We can come to the table and agree vodka's trash.
Yeah, no one like vodka is for like old ladies who are trying to do something with themselves in the middle of the day. 16-year-olds, because it's easy to 16, 17-year-olds who are trying to steal it from their parents' liquor cabinet because they can throw a little bit of water in there and get away with it.
Yep. Just don't throw it in the freezer, you dummies.
And that's I guess pretty much it.
Yeah.
And James Bond in martinis.
Yeah.
But that's because he masks it with, what's it called? Olive juice.
Yeah. Okay, so I've never been a fan of martinis. Do you? I mean, obviously, you know, we don't like vodka, but like, have you ever enjoyed a martini?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Definitely.
So I have, there's a restaurant called Javier's in Newport Beach. They serve a martini. It's called the Black Mamba. It's dedicated to Kobe Bryant. That is probably the only martini I've ever had that I actually enjoyed. Everything else, every other martini I've had, I'm kind of like, ugh. Like a Manhattan.
Manhattan is not a martini.
It's a martini, but it's made with whiskey.
Manhattan is not a martini. It's not served in a martini glass. It's served in a rocks glass.
Is, wow. The bars that I've been to, they've served it in a martini glass.
I've never seen
that's crazy.
A Manhattan in a...
Yeah.
I could be wrong.
The two times that I've had it, they serve it to me in a martini glass. So that's why I figured that's why it was still in the realm.
Yay. It's fair. Yeah. I could be wrong. I know sometimes it's like a
highball drink, right?
Yeah, highball or...
Rocks glass.
What's the other one called? It's like a gooper or something like that. I don't remember.
The hurricane glass?
Okay, and then what was it? What'd you say it's called? Black?
Black Mamba.
Black Mamba drink Javier's. Oh, wow. That popped up.
Yeah.
Let's see. What is this drink? Sky, raspberry vodka, Malibu rum, Chambord, pineapple, and orange juice. Of course you would like it. It's sweet as hell.
Yeah.
That's so sugary.
I had five.
I know.
They're delicious.
You said that. They sound good.
They were really good.
Yeah, when I worked at the bar, I've tried a couple different. I had a couple different martinis because we had some people who really liked like just regular dirty martinis. Mm-hmm. I thought those tasted gross. And then also I don't like dry vermouth.
I was gonna say, you know what's gross is vermouth.
I mean, no one that's you're not meant, supposed to that's drink meant it straight, like cocktail,
but, right? Yeah, but vermouth, it's just
yeah, especially dry vermouth. Yeah. Hard pass. Sweet vermouth, on the other hand,
you can cook with vermouth.
I can get
too.
Down with that. And then can you? What do you mm-hmm. cook with vermouth with?
No clue. You just
know that it's a thing.
I just know that it's a thing that, you know, bartenders say you cook with it.
I've seen
some bakers bake with vermouth. And
I've seen it on Iron Chef.
Gordon Ramsay? Hell's Kitchen, right?
Yeah, he's Hell's Kitchen. and then, fuck, what were we just talking about? I lost my train of thought.
Vodka. Trash.
Oh, yeah. And then I've had like other ones. Like I remember when I was younger, when I would go to like Chili's, love that place, or like Applebee's. Love that place too.
Two for ones, baby.
With they always had these like chocolate martinis, and I always wanted one.
Yeah.
And like my mom would get one, or like my dad would get one because it's just a sugar drink.
Mm-hmm.
And I would be like, can I try it? Like, it looks like an ice cream milkshake. Like, please. And they're like, no, there's a bunch of alcohol in it. You can't drink it. And I was like, I was like, when I turn 21, I'm like, I swear to God, we better come here. And yeah, eventually I had one. I thought it was awesome. Though, as an aside, speaking of that, the Roosevelt in the hotel in Hollywood has like alcohol milkshakes. And we went there once with some friends because we did something else that night. I can't remember what it was. And so we stopped over there like, oh, alcohol milkshakes. That sounds awesome. Those were
gross.
I'm hoping that it was just a bad night.
Yeah.
Because also the food that we got was absolutely terrible.
Oh, wow. Roosevelt?
We had our entire thing comped. Because it was like the food was horrible. The drinks, like literally none of us drank our drinks. We like all took a couple sips and we're like, no, thank you.
Wow.
So we ended up like ordering food, ordering drinks, and then leaving. And ended up paying for nothing because we were like, this was all was gross.
It
just,
okay, so for the drinks, was it poorly made, like over alcohol compensation? Or was it just, did it just taste bad?
It just tasted bad from what I remember. Because I can generally deal with like a strong drink.
Like a strong pour, yeah.
Yeah, but it was just nothing tasted like good.
That's crazy.
It was super weird.
That's crazy.
So I hope to go back one day and hopefully they'll be vindicated. I'm a firm believer on the you got to try everything twice mm-hmm. type of mentality mm-hmm. just in case the first one was a fluke mm-hmm. and it was bad.
Brian, if you're listening, use that to your advantage.
Well, I've already made my passes at him and he turns me down. I'm not his type. he doesn't like white guys.
I don't think it exists anymore. There was a bar in La Crescenta Montrose area and they had alcoholic milkshakes as well. And I remember getting the Irish car bomb milkshake or the Irish mint milkshake, and it was Jameson and Guinness and then mint ice cream world up, and that was delicious.
That sounds good.
It was absolutely delicious. I was hesitant because, you know, Irish car bomb, right? As soon as I had one sip, I was just like, I downed
that. I don't know. What do you mean?
We were like, oh, the ice cream.
Oh, because it has ice cream?
Because it had ice cream.
Oh, okay.
It was a whole-ass milkshake.
Yeah. Whole-ass
milkshake.
With
whole-ass milk.
Sounds good. I had a hard... why are we talking about booze? But whatever. It's far from the topic at hand.
Yeah.
I guess they sometimes can go hand-in-hand. Anyway, yeah. I had like a weird kick of like coffee and like Kahlua.
Yeah. Oh, I like that.
Like... or Bailey's, yeah. And like you know, Irish coffee.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, like for a little while, I was very into that. I'm like, yeah, of course I'm gonna drink this. I want to die.
Yeah, I think I had a very similar. Oh my god, I had a very similar phase, I guess, where it's like, I would save it for like weekends or when I wasn't working. I had coffee, pour some Bailey's in there, and just sip on it. And you're like, oh shit, this is bomb.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, but I prefer Kahlua too. There's a I used to make a vodka drink.
What about a cider drink? Did you ever have a lager drink?
Yeah, I did.
You ever sing any songs that remind you of the good times?
I sang a lot of songs that remind me of the better times.
Good job, Danny boy. Anyway,
are you thumb thumping? So what was I saying? You broke me.
A vodka drink.
Oh, a vodka drink. Right. It had Kahlua. Chocolate coconut vodka and milk. And I called it a hapia pie because it tasted like the Hawaiian dessert hapia pie. But so not a lot of people enjoyed that.
What was in it again?
Oh, it was a chocolate coconut vodka. It had Kahlua and milk. And I would put chocolate syrup at the bottom to give it that extra punch of chocolate.
The so extra chocolate?
Yeah, it didn't like... kill you with vodka and milk. So, yeah, it was one of my favorite dessert drinks.
Okay.
Yeah.
That sounds good. I can get behind that.
I'll have to make it for you.
Yeah, sure. I'll drink it. Why not? That's what it was. Some of those like weird, like the, oh man. So I remember when I was at the bar, we had a newer bartender come in and they were making someone asked for a white Russian,
mm-hmm.
and for whatever reason, they decided, this is also just a tale for anybody out there. If you're ever doing like dairy, within a drink, like you have to use like top shelf liquor or mm-hmm. like alcohol.
Yes.
Cause it'll curdle the milk.
Yes.
And so this person made a white Russian and gave it to somebody. And they were like, weren't paying any attention. Then they went to go drink it and like spit it back out, like all over the bar. Cause they're like, what the hell?
Yeah.
And we were just like looking at it. We're like, yay, making cheese. Like, yeah. All right. It's awesome.
Yeah. You cannot use well shit for dairy drinks.
No,
not at all.
But the, speaking of like, you know, drinks. So the shot that salted, that caramel salted pretzel
yes.
shot that I was telling you
yes.
about.
Yes.
Or chocolate salted pretzel.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus. So the bar that I used to work at, for whatever reason, had some like weird deal with like Pinnacle,
okay.
which I don't know if Pinnacle still exists anymore.
Hmm.
But it was a vodka that they would do like all these like wacky ass flavors.
Yeah.
And so
I think that's the coconut one that I have.
It might have been.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I actually think they're done because I wanted to buy more of the coconut chocolate because it was very limited.
Yeah.
And I think I was able to buy the last bottle that Trader Joe's had.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, so for whatever reason, our bar had a bunch of them. At like a full shelf dedicated to it.
They were fucking cheap.
Yeah, it was gross.
Yeah.
One of the worst hangovers of my life was thanks to Pinnacle Vodka. I thought I was going to die. But we did, anyway. So it was the Pinnacle whipped cream vodka.
Oh, I remember that.
And then it was Frangelico.
Uh-huh.
And then like a sauna salted rim.
Yeah.
And it was awesome. It tasted so good.
What is... Have you had a chocolate cake shot?
Uh-huh.
What is in that? I can't remember for the life of me. I know it has nothing to do with chocolate, though.
I don't remember.
Fuck, I like those chocolates.
It's been a long while.
I like the chocolate cake.
There's a bunch of variations on stuff like that, yeah. But I imagine it was probably like Bailey's. Bailey's was probably in it. It could have been Frangelico, because Frangelico is kind of like a chocolate, like hazelnut flavor. I feel like
Frangelico was, yeah.
I'm a little out of the game in that one.
You and me both.
But what was it? Oh yeah. I mean, I don't want to share that one. Never mind.
What about tequila? You got any gripes with tequila?
I just don't really like it.
No?
I like it in like drinks. Yeah. Like I can do like mixed drinks with tequila in it, but
not
like
shooting it or sipping it.
I'm done with shooting. Like doing shots.
Yeah.
And I was pretty much done with that phase of my life at like 21.
Mm-hmm.
I'll say. I was done with doing shots real early. And yeah. It like at this point, it like makes me mad when people are like, we're gonna do shots. I'm like, how old are you?
Yeah.
I'm over here trying to drink classy.
Well, what's worse too is like people are like, we're gonna do shots, and they like get shots of the cheapest shit. And I'm over here like, can you just give me a glass of whiskey, please? Like, I don't want to take a shot. If I have to take a shot, give me a shot of like Maker's Mark or Crown, like something that's sweet and easy.
Yeah. The last time that I went out, it was turned into like a bunch of like Fireball shots.
Oh.
And that is the worst.
Oh.
I love cinnamon, but hard pass.
Oh, Fireball's pretty, ugh, it's rough.
It's so gross.
Did you have the rum chata when it came out?
Hell yeah.
Did you like it?
In
moderation?
Yes. Yeah. We another thing that we stored at my bar. And that was more often than not the shots that we were giving out was like rum chata, which we were doing at like a discount because it's like cheap. It's like 7% alcohol. Yeah. Like it's not that bad.
It's also like $7 a bottle.
Yeah. So it was so cheap. I thought it tasted super like pretty good.
I liked it. I really enjoyed it. So I mean, I got an actual horchata and added rum chata to it.
That sounds awesome.
It was pretty good.
I feel like rum chata and like coffee would go well together too.
I haven't tried that, but now that you say that, sounds pretty good.
Again, another drink that I don't know. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
I don't even know if they still make that.
As soon as you said cinnamon, that was the first thing that came to mind besides Fireball.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. Yeah. We used to, every time that I hang out with, it's like Brian, they're always like, we're going to do Fireball shots. I'm like, who are you?
Yeah. What are we, 12?
Shit is Jesus. Gross. What's next? Yeah. Jaeger shots? Like, come on.
There's a handful of golf courses. They're trying to get rid of those little Fireball bottles. Like, you know, like how Costco had like the 40 pack that you could buy for $20.
Yeah, like the airline ones.
Yeah, so like they have a shit ton of those at the golf courses, and they're like doing specials. They're like, oh yeah, buy two beers, get a shot of Red Bull or Fireball. And so like we'd buy it. I'm like, no, you can keep the Fireball. We don't want it.
Yeah, just pour it out.
Yeah,
it's like Fireball to me is the same as like pumpkin vodka, or not pumpkin vodka, like pumpkin beer in like during around Halloween.
Yeah.
And the best way to drink it is not. To not. So I want it eradicated.
Yeah.
Like,
pumpkin beer needs to go.
I had a friend who was really into pumpkin beer, and I sent him this video of me just like cracking it open and just pouring it straight into the toilet.
You're a monster.
And I was like enjoying my pumpkin beer.
I've had it once, and it was one of those like, Deflo put it best. He was like, it's short-lived. You sip it, you get a taste for the flavor, but it's not memorable. And you're just like, all right, I'm done.
No, it tastes terrible. Because like whenever I've had them, my thought is always like, I want this to taste like a pumpkin pie.
Yeah.
But it doesn't.
No, it's the furthest thing from
it. It tastes like somebody filtered like a it's usually like a lager or like a stout.
Yeah.
Through a pumpkin,
yeah,
or a couple pumpkins, and it's almost like
and those pumpkins were broken open and stepped on, on the street.
It's almost like not LaCroix, but yeah, it's kind of like LaCroix, where it's like you're getting like the essence of a flavor, but like it's not quite the flavor,
right,
and like some of them are better than others, but like that's what pumpkin beer is just like I kind of feel like I can taste
this
pumpkin
is a stout with the essence of pumpkin,
but it tastes like shit.
It's like a spritz.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's like, what's, but why?
Right.
It's fuck. Oh, I hate it.
Yeah. Pumpkin beer.
It was all over Chicago for like a long time.
It's got to go.
I was like, get this shit out of my life.
Yeah. There's this combination of beers that Deflo and I were drinking back in the day. They called it a parfait. It's like a chocolate. I think it's either a chocolate stout or a peanut butter stout and a banana stout. You go 2/3 of the glass with both of them, and then you fill with frambois, and it's supposed to like the frambois, you drop it in the middle, let it rise, and then it's supposed to push the peanut butter and the banana up together, and it tastes like a fucking parfait. It's delicious. I haven't made it successfully yet, but
that sounds good.
Yeah, it was delicious.
I can get behind that. Some of the mixing of beers is kind of interesting. You I was about to say something that's not a beer. Yeah, I remember when that kind of like popped up a little bit, where people were doing like mixes of like alcohol, like certain like spirits with a beer, to like kind of have some like weird flavors. I forget what there was a bar that I used to go to that did it all the time, and then we like eventually tried all of them. We're like, yeah, it's okay.
Yeah. I don't know. It's hard to mix a liquor with a beer, unless you're doing a shot.
A shant. Yeah. There's this course that I've really wanted to take for like years now, and I never have. Mm. And it's called a something that I, it's losing me, but it's effectively a sommelier for beer.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always wanted to do that because I thought it'd be really awesome to be able to like learn like flavoring and like flavor profiles and stuff like that. And like how you can like mash that up with food.
Mm-hmm. I was just talking to my cousin Oscar last week, and he loves beer. Like exactly what you said. I don't know if he took the course, but he could tell you flavor notes. He could tell you mixes. He could tell you almost everything there is to know about beer. Yeah. You guys would have a fun time talking about that one.
Is it
sommelier or sommelier?
Depends on how bougie you are.
Sommelier.
I've always heard it sommelier.
Sommelier. It just sounds like the country.
Cicerone is the name of it. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. C-I-C-E-R-O-N-E.
Sounds right.
Cicerone or Cicerone?
Cicerone.
Cicerone. I don't know if it's Italian, but we'll claim it.
Cicerone.
My people. We are now all Cicerones.
Well, sommelier is French, right? Sommelier is French.
Mm-hmm.
So the Italians can have
sommelier, croissant.
Croissant.
One of my clients actually says croissant, and he is not French.
I was going to follow that up. So
he's not close to being French.
That's hilarious.
Family comes from the opposite side of the world. It is
Australia.
Hilarious. No. It's so funny. The other day we were working out, and I was like, what'd you have for breakfast?
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, you know, I had some like eggs, some mozzarella, and he's like, I had it on top of a croissant, and I'm like, who are you? And he's like, well, that's how you say it. He's like, how do you say a croissant? And I'm like, a croissant?
Croissant.
I was like, because I'm a fucking honky.
Yeah.
And like, that's why? Because America?
Yeah. Croissant.
I'm like, it's a croissant. He's like, croissant. He's like, it's the same thing. I'm like, we're not having this conversation. I was like, I understand where you're getting at. You're saying it technically correctly, I believe. So whatever.
Yeah.
You're paying homage to our French peeps.
Yeah.
Go for it. I was like, who says that?
Yeah. Croissant.
Yeah. And he throws out like some of the Italian stuff. He's like, you know, some mozzarella. I'm like, okay.
Mozzarella.
Yeah, I'm like, why? I don't understand why you're saying it like this.
Yeah, he's probably the person that goes to Starbucks and is like, "Can I get a venti chai latte and a croissant?"
A croissant, a croissant,
a croissant.
I mean, he says that unironically, so like he 100% means that.
Yeah, he owns it,
which is fine.
Yeah,
like
it's like Stewie, coo whip,
coo whip,
coo whip. Why are you saying like what? Wow.
Shut up, whiskey. Whiskey. Sorry.
Wow.
Not whiskey.
Oh, Siri?
Siri. Where my head went with that is there's a scene in...
Sorry, I'm having trouble with the connection. Please try again in a moment.
How did I open up Siri?
That's hilarious.
Anyway, so where my head was going was in Hot Rod... They did an entire scene with that, and he's like, "All right, the safe word is whiskey." And he's like, and his brother is like, "Why are you saying it like that?" He's like, "Saying what?" He's like, "Whiskey. You're saying it weird." He's like, "Whiskey." He's like, "Why do you say it like that?" He's like, "Saying whiskey what way?" And they're like, whatever. And so anyway, anything, he goes down and tries to do this stunt, and he's like, "Whiskey, whiskey." And then he crashes into the side of a trailer.
Nice.
And has one of my favorite lines of all time. the guy like this guy he crashes into this trailer and this guy comes out and he's like, what the hell? And one of his like crewmates in it, he's like, you won't mess with me? It's like, I've been drinking green tea all goddamn day.
Oh my god.
He's like, you gonna let the demons out of me? And he like beats him up with a cone. It's really funny. It's the movie's so stupid.
I still haven't watched it yet.
You have to watch that movie. Like it's like means something to me.
Okay.
That you watch this.
Okay.
And if you don't like it, I need you to lie to me.
And tell you I loved it.
Then tell you and just tell me that like, yeah, it was really funny.
Got it.
And then you can just stop there.
Can I tell you I watched it and tell you I loved it?
Ideally in that order.
Okay. Got it.
And yet anything else other than I watched it and I enjoyed it, I don't want to know.
Got it. Perfect.
Speaking of
Jesus Christ at this point.
What? Should we just keep talking about alcohol at this point?
I mean, we literally talk about everything at this point.
What? We were pretty much on topic.
No, I said we could literally talk about
it. Oh, could literally.
Yeah, we could literally talk about it.
Well, the point of what all of this was supposed to be was we were going to chat about music.
Yeah. Eventually, we'll get around to that.
Well, we're already here, so let's just go talk about music. So you brought this up. Like, yeah. What was your... Was there anything in particular that you kind of wanted to, like, muse over?
You know what's crazy is I went to see Yellow Claw, which is a DJ group, Friday? Last Friday? Fuck, I don't remember. Yeah, the 13th. Yeah. And that's my second EDM show ever. And it got me to thinking, like, how music hits people differently, but how different music hits people differently. And I found myself over the weekend listening to more and more EDM, but like also other genres of rock, other just everything, and taking it in and like, as weird as it's going to sound, feeling the music more than just hearing the music.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I don't was going down rabbit holes of music to like 1 in the morning and then realizing, oh shit, I got to go to sleep.
I'm sleepy.
Yeah. And, you know, because like with certain songs or certain genres, you could just stay up all night. Like your head will just bob for 2 hours straight. And then you look at the clock and like, what the hell am I doing still up? Yeah. So that's where my head was at in regards to talking about music.
Okay.
Just the feeling of it.
So, you're 100% on. I think music is such an interesting medium because it's so universal in the sense that like, rhythm and beats, like things that just get you moving, kind of transcend. And this is real hippie talk here, but they really do like kind of transcend the like languages, cultures, like all of these things. Cause like you can listen to music from like tribes, and you can find like you do, there's rhythm and like beat to it that you're like, oh man, I can kind of get behind this. Like it's got an interesting sound or something cool, right? I feel like this exists a lot within like the. Like quote unquote dance music.
Yeah.
Kind of across the world.
Yeah.
I remember I went to this like Russian wedding or Polish wedding many years ago. And it was kind of this like same thing where I was like, I have no idea what's happening, but I was like, man, people are getting down. I like this. I went to an Indian wedding and same thing. Like now that's different. Like that music is very different from like kind of like Western music. In that regard, but it was still along the same lines of like, I don't know what's happening, but I was like, I like it.
Yeah.
And it's again, like get me feeling things.
Yeah. It's something unique about the weird, the different pitches and tones of the instruments that they're using, like the sitar, just how it has a different sound than a guitar. It has a unique vibration. Mm-hmm. And then it hits your ears or it resonates with your ears. And you're like, that's different. That is hitting some sort of serotonin booster. Like you're just like, wow, what is that? And then you get into that rhythm or whatever rhythm the music's playing at, and you're going along with it, whether you understand the lyrics or not.
You're juking and jabbing. You know, it is interesting. Like there's, I wish I could remember his name, cause I would love to throw the shout out there, but there's a musician that does, or a YouTuber, the musician who specifically is like jazz music. And he does a lot where he'll talk about like music theory. And it kind of explain a little bit on how some of these things work. And I find it really intriguing to know, like, and this generally will apply to like most music around the world. But there are, you know, you think of like happy songs or like happy sounds, and I might get this messed up, but I believe it's the major scale, and then, or like major, and then you could think of like sad sounds are like minor.
Mm-hmm.
But then even within, so there's kind of like, we associate certain like chords to
right.
like feelings to a certain degree, right? Kind of sounds happy and kind of sounds sad.
Yeah, like the highs versus the lows, right?
Not necessarily.
Oh.
It's not necessarily like high pitch versus low pitch,
uh-huh.
Like a ha ah, or a ho.
Yeah.
But more so the, it has like a happy sound to it. And
it.
By that, it's like the way that the notes form the chords, it has this kind of like, all of them like resonate well together. And there's also something interesting when you're looking at like chord progressions too, where you can, I'm no music theorist, so apologies if I'm getting this wrong to anybody listening to this that actually understands music. So pardon my ignorance. But the other interesting part is like through certain chord progressions, you kind of have this like kind of like flow to it, right? Where it's like kind of happy, happy, happy. And you can also then cause like this like dissonance that kind of leaves the feeling unresolved. And then you can like then resolve the feeling. And so like you hear this in like movies and whatnot, where the way the music kind of, I feel like good music in movies is more of a backup mm-hmm. rather than the front facing thing that's happening.
Right.
And so if you find that you're able to, like you might find if you're ever listening to like certain movies that have like really good like conductors and scores mm-hmm. that you'll find yourself feeling anxious while like feeling anxiety through something. And
yeah.
then the music literally can cause the anxiety and then also resolve the anxiety. And like through these like kind of progressions through music, like chords, you can elicit feelings off of it because you get this like this wanting for more.
Right.
And then you finally will get it and you're like, oh, finally I'm there. Like, all right,
right.
sweet. And I find that so intriguing.
Yeah.
It's sorry. I mean, I know you're about to say something, but to finish my thought, it's very similar to, you can think of it as like the come up, or like pre-chorus for say like a DJ.
Yeah.
Right. Where like the beat builds, the tempo builds, the music gets louder, 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 and you're waiting for that beat drop. And that's kind of that same thing, right? Like you almost feel the anxiety because you're like, I know what's about to happen. You have the anticipation of what's about to happen. Then mm-hmm. it finally hits and you're just like, yes, like, ugh!
Yeah.
All right. And you get going. And that's kind of what that is.
No, for sure. I think, as you were saying about movies and scores, I think one track that does it really well is the Star Wars theme, right? You start off with blank screen, right? You get some words on the screen, and then all of a sudden they just come in with a loud, right? And like it gets you up. You're excited. You're reading it. You're following along with the story. But then it dissolves out, right? It dissolves out, and it leaves you in that anxious state of like, wait, what happens next?
Mm-hmm.
Right, like it fades out. You get the do-do-do-do, and then it fades, and then the movie starts or the action scene starts, and you're like, "Oh shit, I'm in it!" Right? I think that's the perfect example of like the opposite of the beat dropping. Like it's the beat starts and then it fades out, versus like where an EDM song, it's like the build up it starts and then the beat drops and everybody goes fucking crazy.
Mm-hmm.
But I think another one that does it is Pirates of the Caribbean's big theme song, the dun, 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 mm-hmm. that one. Like those two are probably two of my favorite composed movie songs of all time. There's something about the sounds in them where they get you so excited for what's going to happen or what's going on on the scene. And you're just like, and the other thing too is they're just so memorable, so notable. You're just like, I know exactly what that is.
Yes, 100%. Music scores are so interesting in how they can do that. But I guess like, yeah, just like music as a whole is like, it's very intriguing how it can work. Especially like, I think a really good example, like when you look at like good examples of some of this stuff is like classical music.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because you can see and feel that even more. Now from like an orchestral standpoint, you definitely are aware of that. As an aside, if you've never been to an orchestra performance, I highly recommend it.
Yeah.
Even if you're not a fan of the music itself, there is something about, I mean, there's something about live music.
Yes.
Because you can literally feel it.
Live instrumental music.
Yes.
As well.
So, but there's something like classical music is a really good expression of kind of what we're talking about, because it's the basis of it is trying to elicit feelings, right? You think of, like, you have like the bass, you have violin, like the, you know, or bass sounds, mm-hmm. like you have like mids and highs, you have you can change to a certain degree like the direction at which you're hearing stuff on, like, you know, the swells and whatnot, and like it's very interesting to like to just feel the roller coaster of, I guess, like emotion, if you can actually sit there and kind of like listen and feel at this, like feel what you're feeling at the same time as you go through it.
Absolutely.
It's really intriguing.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen like an orchestra performance?
I've seen, so not specifically.
Not like high school?
Right. Yeah. No, not specifically orchestra, but like I've seen The Lion King live. I've seen Les Mis live, Phantom live, right? So like getting to hear and feel that music. It's a whole other feeling. Like it's not like watching it on the movie. Like, yeah, you can hear it and you can audibly feel it, but like being in the concert hall and getting the chills of like, I mean, this is just for me, but like hearing the strings play, that resonation hits your body just like it hits your ears, and you're just like, for me, it gives me chills. If I like hear a song or hear a note and I'm like, oh, I like that. Like my whole body goes, ooh.
I too like
this. Yeah, I like that. And it feels good to be at live music and just feel that music. And I think for me, that's what I was doing upstairs, and I was just listening. Like I had it blasted in my headphones and I was just like, I was just feeling the music. Like
just vibing.
Oh yeah, man. And everything that came on, I was just like, I liked it. And if I didn't like it, I skipped it, right?
Perfect.
If you don't like it, skip it.
The wonders of the internet.
God, I love that.
I also think too, when you're looking at like live music, you're hearing stuff that specifically in like orchestral in the sense, you're hearing stuff that you're not normally going to hear unless you have like really good, like high fidelity, like headphones.
Yeah.
As well as it's coming from a very high quality source.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we look at like MP3s and whatnot, like, which is how most music we're listening to this day is, it's all compressed. Mm-hmm. And so when we start compressing music, like we start losing aspects of it. So there's going to be parts that you're not going to be able to hear just by the basis of digitizing and compressing like a piece. So that's also a part too that I find like is really cool. Like when you go see a live show, or specifically orchestral in this sense, then you get to like hear parts that you could not hear before,
right?
Watching Lion King off the, you know, off of your TV.
Mm-hmm.
You might have great, like pretty good speakers, but
yeah,
it's only so good,
right?
The output's only, or the thing, the source is only so good,
right? Another thing that I forgot, I don't know how I forgot this, I was thinking about it right now, is my favorite thing that I've seen live, kind of live, right? Is I saw Danny Elfman conduct and perform Nightmare Before Christmas at the Hollywood Bowl.
That would be really cool.
It was beyond badass because that's one of my favorite movies. It's one of my favorite musical scores of all Disney music.
So you used to shop at Hot Topic too then when you were a kid, yeah?
Oh, fuck yeah. Oh, hell yeah. But like getting to, you know, him, watching him conduct and sing along when he had his parts is just like, it took it a whole nother level. Like as a fan, I had such a higher appreciation for the music that went into that movie.
Yeah. Yeah. Music plays a huge role, man. It's really cool.
Yeah.
It's when done, like I said, when done well, I don't know why I said, like I said, cause I don't think I actually said anything, but when done well, it really is something like, one of the things in like, so I'm a rock fan, right? I prefer rock music, kind of in most genres. I like punk and hard rock, right? Just rock in its entirety. And I like something that always really gets me is like harmonizing.
Mm-hmm.
And so like Bad Religion,
yeah,
I really like Bad Religion, right?
Yeah, me too.
And so when I went to go see them the last time, like every time, because they were big into like, or not big into, but they have like a decent amount of songs that will have like vocal harmonies. And I don't know what it is about that, but it just like shivers down my spine. And I was like,
yeah,
sign me up. I love it.
One of my favorite songs is, I don't know if it's the title, but Los Angeles is Burning.
That's the name of the song.
I love that song.
Yeah.
I love that song. I love the vocals. I love the music. I love the instrumental through it. It's just like, that's probably one of my favorite songs from them.
Yeah. Well, I can't wait till when we go.
Oh, hell yeah. Hell yeah.
It's going to be awesome.
You know what's also short and sweet, but like memorable and still gives you that feeling of anxiety is the Jaws theme song.
Oh,
it's literally just burning, right? But as it builds, you're hearing different strings come in. You're hearing different, like, and when you're sitting there, I mean, I would probably get the chills seeing it live or hearing it perform live, but even on the TV, right? If you have good quality speakers, you can feel and hear those strings come in on different level. And you're just like, it's like, oh, that buildup is so awesome.
Well, there's also the, it like, good music in that regard also plays on like anticipation.
Yes.
So it's also what's not being played is an interesting part, because the gaps in the like notes or whatever is being like whatever, you kind of, if it goes just like a hair too long, you kind of like lean into it. You're mm-hmm. like, what's that? Right. It's the same thing with like conversations. If you're ever talking to somebody who's a really good storyteller,
right,
you'll notice this in like in the,
they'll hit those pauses.
The precise pauses, right? You'll be in the middle of a conversation and like something, they're kind of building up a little bit and they have this, you know, they can have this kind of longer pause that makes you feel like you're waiting for something, right? You might've just felt that same thing when I did that. and it's strategy and it's very strategic. Like comedians, stand-up comedy is very, very good at like...
Oh, it's timing.
Timing is literally everything. Mm-hmm. You move too fast into the next one, it can resolve the tension that you're trying to build. Or if you're going too slow, then you almost then shift it in the opposite direction, and like people get like too anxious and then they fall off.
Yeah. They're like, oh, that was what I was waiting for.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And it's very interesting how you have to like play the game.
Yeah.
With like conversation, music, it's the exact same thing. So, like, right. I think Jaws is one of those really good ones where, like, that, like, dun-dun, and it's a pretty decent pause.
Yeah, it's a good pause before it starts to actually build up. And even in the build up, there's still hesitation.
Yeah, it's that split second, right? Yeah. And like, the difference in, like, time signatures can, like, definitely play that into you where you're, right? Because we're so used to a certain cadence to things happening of, like, you know, like, usually, like, a 1, 2, 3, 4 type of thing.
Yeah.
And so now if it's like, okay, it's a one, like, dun, dun, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, what's happening right mm-hmm. now? And you're like, oh, and then it hits again. You're like, oh, shit.
You're like, wait, my body's not ready for that.
Yeah, right. It's exactly like, you know, when you start playing with things like that, it's very weird how it can mess with you. Yeah. We should have somebody on who knows the music to like talk about this.
So Kyle, where are you?
Yeah, I know, right? And I was like, I almost was like, I should give her a call and be like, hey.
What are you doing right now?
We have some we're going to have some idiotic conversations. Can we get a professional in? To just like shoot the shit as well.
I'm sure we're actually making her proud right now.
Maybe.
I think she'd be pretty proud of us.
For
having like no professional music background, I think we know what we're talking about. Okay. As far as music goes.
As far as non-professionals, we're crushing it right
now. We are crushing it. We would be semi-pro at best right now.
We are currently the embodiment of the Dunning-Kruger effect.
Yeah.
So anyway, the thing that I find interesting though, when we're looking at like you're talking about kind of the, I also feel like atmosphere plays a really big role into that as well.
Yeah, very much so.
So EDM's not really my genre of music that I very rarely listen to it. Mm-hmm. Outside of like going to a show.
Yeah.
Like if I go to a show, I can definitely enjoy it way more.
Yeah.
Because I feel like the environment plays such a big role. Like there's, whether you believe it or not, like there's kind of this like energy that you can kind of feel. Like most of the places that I've gone to a show, like gone to shows that are at the Palladium. And so I just know like just walking in, I can kind of like, you can almost like feel it of just like people are just excited.
Yeah.
Like people are just like, it seems to be like a happier thing.
Yeah.
Whether that's chemically induced or not, but it's like people feel good. Like, or they're feeling good. You can kind of, you're kind of like feeding off of that energy.
Right.
Right. But then the concept behind it is like, then everyone's not everyone, but like people are there to like dance. Like mm-hmm. a lot of people are there to dance.
Right.
And like, you don't normally dance cause you're angry. So there's like, there's just this like constant feedback loop of like, people are having a good time. You're feeling people having a good time. Like it just, it always like feeds into itself. Which is part of the reason why I'm starting to, like, I want to go to more EDM shows.
Mm-hmm.
Not even like, and it's weird to say this, like, not because of the music, but because of just like
the ambiance,
the ambience that I feel from just being
at the show.
So yeah. I was like, man, I feel good just being here.
Yeah. To touch real quick before any internet trolls try to come at us, you said you don't typically dance when you're angry. That includes mosh pits, guys. Like, people don't go into mosh pits because they're fucking angry. Yes, they may have some tension built up, but they're doing it because they love the music. That's a happy feeling. That's like you're going in there and you're moshing with other people who love to do it too. It's not like you're going in there to fight. Like you want to fight. Like you're not angry.
Well, yes and no.
You, like I said, you have that angst built up in you, but you're not like, you're not going to a mosh pit or you're not going to a mosh pit and you're not going to find a guy and be like, I'm going to fuck you up because I had a bad day.
Well,
oh God, am I yes, wrong on that?
You're, Jesus, you're not. I would say on average,
yeah,
you're correct.
Okay,
there
are the outliers,
but there are. I don't even know. I would say outliers.
Oh wow.
So like, the because there was a lot of fights that I have either witnessed that I've witnessed
yeah.
in like back in the day going to like more punk shows.
Mm-hmm.
Right, because it is a little bit more chaotic.
Yeah,
I mean, it's not a little bit; it's a lot more chaotic. It tends to be like fueled by something. So, for example, or like a prime example of this is BC.
BC.
2019 BC or yeah BC.
2019 BC.
We went to go see Misfits.
Okay,
so stoked. That was awesome. Awesome show. And I wanted to go get into the mosh pit because I was like, this brings me back
yeah.
like years. I'm yeah. very stoked about this. Until it was just like constant watching people get the shit beat out of them.
Really?
Like there were so many people being escorted out of the mosh pit and just out of the stands as a whole because really? People were just fighting like crazy.
That's insane.
So not uncommon.
I guess, right? I from the shows that I've been to, all the pits that I've been to or seen, if you go down, for the most part, people are going to, you know, keep going on top of you, but there's going to be somebody picking you up. Like, but that person who goes down doesn't immediately turn around and look for the person that, and like, there's no huge altercations from what I've been to and seen.
Yes. And as you're saying that, I'm also going into like, I think it also depends on the genre of music.
Okay.
Because where my head immediately went to is like a lot of the punk shows.
Yeah.
And that there's almost guaranteed going to be a fight. Like it's almost without question.
Yeah.
But then I've also been to like metal shows and it's not quite the same.
Yeah.
Like less often have I seen like just straight up like fist fights.
Right.
Just happening.
So maybe it's just you punk kids.
Or like when I went to go see Bad Religion, like mm-hmm. there was a mosh pit. Like I didn't, as far as I'm aware, I don't really see any fights.
Yeah.
Right. So I think it just depends.
Yeah.
So we'll say maybe like a yes and a no.
Yeah. So everyone else is cool except punk.
77, baby. If you know, you know.
I'm more of an emo kid.
Cut your wrist and black your eyes, baby.
All day. All day.
Yeah, I've always wondered if an emo show is just a lot of people just like huddled together standing like this. You know what I mean?
It is.
You're just like, they're like,
No, it's not. Right. Cause it's weird. Emo, the emo category is so far stretched.
It's very...
It's so far stretched. Questionable. You're like, yeah, like you have those in the corner, you know, huddling up together. But then you have those who are just lively and enjoy the music. I'm more that side.
Yeah.
Like, I love the emo music. I mean, for the quality of the sound. But, like, you know, when you're a fucking high schooler, those lyrics hit you for some reason, even though you haven't had a hard life, right? That's just what emo does to you.
I guess.
Yeah.
You see, you took the sad route. I took the angry route.
Yeah, well, that's fair. But see, I was never sad. That's the best part about it. Like, I don't know. I loved emo music, but I was never a sad kid, ever.
Did you had MySpace, right?
Yeah.
Do you remember the band Scene Aesthetic?
No.
Damn it. I like. There's some like 31-year-old girl right now who went yes. Who's listening to this? Because that was like such a weirdly specific MySpace blow up song.
Yeah.
That was like just so popular. I feel like it was on every girl's playlist.
Was
like,
the band Scene Aesthetic or the song was Scene Aesthetic?
I think the band was called Scene Aesthetic.
Oh, okay. You don't remember the name of the song?
No. I can try and look it up. Okay. But it was, so, yeah.
I do remember the MySpace days where you could, you know, put in your player, you could pick your top 8 and then 16 and then 24 and then Jesus Christ, it kept going.
It might not.
I still think MySpace is infinitely better than Facebook.
You know what? Now that I'm saying this, it might not have been the Scene Aesthetic.
Uh-oh.
Oh, man. No.
Yes?
Yeah, this is it.
Nice. 100%.
You want me to play it?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Is this it? Yeah. Okay. Can't wait for this to get taken down in North Korea. It always gets taken down in like weird ass countries.
No music for you.
I don't know why I'm playing through this. Oh, whatever.
Hey, sweetie.
Oh, if you watch the music video, it's like, I mean, this was like 2000, like 5 or something like that. Or no, it probably a little bit earlier than that. Yeah, it's called Beauty and the Breakdown. God, it's so, this like brings me back way too many like young memories of Ryan. Have you ever heard, you've never heard this song?
No.
It's so whiny.
Well, I mean, most emo was.
It has to be. Is it?
You know, I've never heard the song, no. But we should redo it.
I'd be down for
you
that.
And I should redo it.
All right.
I'll do the, what is it, falsetto parts?
Actually, there was no falsetto on that.
I just threw that word out there. I can't remember what Kyle told me about it.
Falsetto is like high register.
Oh. Like Brandon.
What?
Fuck.
Careful, whatever you're about to say. No, oh, Brendan Urie.
Yeah, Murray, thank you.
You say Murray?
Murray.
Brendan Murray.
Brendan Murray.
From Peanut Gator Disco.
Yeah, that one.
Sorry, hold on one sec. So, Brendan Urie, actually, I'm not 100% sure in some of his songs if he actually goes into falsetto or not.
Is that just even above what his range? Because remember the Frozen song?
Yeah, Into the Unknown.
Yeah.
That's not falsetto.
Really?
He just has a super high register.
How give me an example of what falsetto is in so I can know.
Like a song that has falsetto?
Yeah. Like is Mariah Carey's shit falsetto?
Yes, actually. That's called a whistle tone.
Oh, whistle tone.
But yes, that is like ultra high falsetto.
Okay. I'm trying to think shit. Okay, if that's
cuz like cuz generally women aren't considered falsetto. It's more of a
male,
kind of a more of a male thing, but okay. Yes.
Yeah, I can't. Damn, I'm trying to think.
Yeah, so it's like it's right. I mean, I'm not gonna do it.
No,
but,
no.
But you can get like you can go pretty high and just like a regular like your like head your regular speaking voice to a certain degree.
I can keep going up like this.
Yeah, but it's you can keep going at a certain point, but then it's like there's that flip where it goes. Hey, and then I talk like this.
That's it.
And that would be like falsetto.
Got it. Yeah, no, I couldn't sing at that.
You can. It's practice. It's really weird. I remember like it's been a minute since I've done a session, but it's really interesting to like have to because you have to learn how to like like almost exclusively blow air out of your nose
while doing it,
like while you're like that high.
Oh man, that'd be tough.
It's and it's like it's really weird too, because then like what every time that I start doing that, and it's because I haven't like practiced that high in a long time or in a while. Whenever I do go to do it, it like rattles like my nose, and I have like keep sneezing.
Oh yeah,
and it like makes me stuffy because it just like it's literally just like rocking shit out of my nose.
Yeah,
it's so weird.
Maybe I have done that like in the car, because like there are some songs that'll go up, but I'm just like. I do one of those like nose itches or nose like rubs.
No, that's good. That means you're hitting like the soft palate like at the top and like in your nose, like nasal resonators.
Hell yeah, nailed it.
It's weird when you actually start doing it and like you're hitting it for a while. You're like,
yeah,
like ugh.
But then I'm like, hell yeah, I nailed that song. And then my carpool karaoke's over.
Yeah, and then you're talking like this for the rest of the day. Pretty much, you're blowing out your vocal cords.
Yeah, pretty much.
So you're pushing too hard. Okay, so then speaking on music, who is the most underrated band in your eyes, and why is it Nickelback?
I'm gonna have to say it's Nickelback, because I think they get a false rap that everybody hates them, when in fact probably 90% of the population that's listened to them enjoys them.
I agree.
Yeah,
I think Nickelback gets such a bad rap.
Yeah.
And I don't know where that came from.
I think it was a late 90s, early 2000s thing where they were, I think they were trying, not compete, but they were put in the competition category between all the new rock that was coming out. And people were just like, oh, Nickelback's trash, Nickelback's trash. So like that kind of carried on. It was, like you listen to Nickelback, you're like, it's not bad. It doesn't sound bad. My head's moving. Like I can sing along. Like, yeah, I don't know. I don't know why or how Nickelback got such a bad rap.
I agree.
Look at this photograph.
You know, at this point, it's like, I feel like they've made the turn into more of like memedom. And so like, they're kind of like fun to listen to, but like How You Remind Me.
One of the greatest songs.
Far Away, Rockstar, Photograph.
We all wanna be. Oh, just be big rock stars.
Lullaby was a big one. Someday was a big one. Gotta Be Somebody. Like there's actually a couple. I just like googled it.
They had a huge radio playing. Huge.
Like,
watch, I'm gonna piss people off. They were as entertaining as Nirvana.
I don't have any counter to that. I understand the
sure somebody's face just twitched.
I understand the cultural prevalence or the cultural influence that Nirvana had on kind of that turn to the turn of like grunge music and stuff, and whatnot, but I'm not a Nirvana fan. Also, I guess while we're airing our dirty secrets, I'm not a Beatles fan either.
You're not a Beatles fan?
No.
Oh man,
I it's one of those I appreciate them for what they are. They were a massive, like a massive cultural shift and influence into like music and like, I mean they were like, they were considered like. Like Satan music, right? Or they were going against like American morals and values, right? Because their shit was like weirdly deemed sexual, which wasn't.
Then they came to America and all the women threw panties on stage.
And then they were bigger than God. So yeah,
pretty much.
So, but I appreciate what they did and where and what they like are, but I don't really like, I don't enjoy listening to their music.
Yeah. You're not going to be like, oh, you know what? I want to listen to the Beatles.
That sentence has never left my lips.
Nice.
So, yeah. But again, whatever.
I love Queen.
I think Queen's really good.
I love Queen.
It's the vocal aspects, right? Oh, that gets me.
100%. 100%.
Freddie Mercury. Freddie Mercury is interesting too, because he had like a weird mouth.
Yeah.
And so it gave him like an ability to like,
he had an extra range or some shit.
Like sing in different ways.
Mm-hmm. Out the side of his mouth, the top of his mouth.
Well, it's because it had the shape of his mouth allowed like resonance in a different way. So it's like kind of really hard to sing very close to him.
Yeah.
He also had like wild range too, so he'd be able to. He had very good control and of the dynamics. Any other bands that you're like that are like really popular that you don't like?
That I don't like?
Or vice versa?
Let's see. I mean, for the most part, I like all music except Offspring. Trying to think who else I don't like.
You said that to hurt me. It's rude.
I think Green Day is overplayed and overrated.
I would agree with you on that one.
Yeah.
I never really got into Green Day. I got another one.
Dookie. That was like one of their top albums, right? And it's just like, okay, like I get it. Like, you know.
I mean, they had like three or four big albums.
Right, right. But when I was growing up, right?
Yeah.
That was their out album. Like, yeah, we're going to fucking take over the scene. And I was just like, okay, this is cool. Like, it's entertaining, but I wouldn't pay to go see Green Day.
Yeah. Here's mine, Blink 182.
I was just about to say, I think Blink 182 is overrated.
It's and here's the thing, because again, it's not that I don't necessarily dislike their music,
mm-hmm.
but I also won't seek it out.
Right.
And I know I've been called on this shit before too, because people have like, I've heard you sing entire songs, and it's like, yeah, I heard it straight for like 5 years.
Yeah.
It's
and that's
my entire life.
That's another thing, right? So people will tell me like, oh, I thought you hated this band, or I thought you hated this song. I was like, doesn't mean I don't know all the words and I don't enjoy singing. I don't enjoy music. There's a complete difference. Like, I will not pay to go see this band. I will not purchase an album. I won't go out of my way to fund whatever it is, like, because I don't want to. Doesn't mean I'm not going to sing it. Doesn't mean I don't know all the words.
Yeah. It's a weird duality.
Yeah. God, I had that argument. I've had that argument my whole life. Like Green Day, right? I think they're overrated. Do I know all the popular Green Day songs?
We all know Boulevard of Broken Dreams.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just like, yes, I know all. That's another thing with my brain is like, I have more lyrics in my brain than probably anything else going back to the 90s.
Naturally.
Yeah. Like, my storage is at capacity, so all the new songs are pushing out old songs, so I don't listen to new shit anymore. I'm just like, I don't want to listen to all this garbage. I want to keep all my good stuff.
I just want my good stuff, the music back in my day.
Yeah, damn it. Who's another one? Who else do you think? Also, I have no appreciation for Offspring.
Okay, you don't have to keep...
They're just
you could stop
loud
now.
And whiny.
You just said how about emo music, and it is literally loud and whiny.
Is it emo punk? Can we classify Offspring as emo punk?
Emo, but, well, one, Offspring is not emo. It would not at worst, they'd be considered pop punk.
Pop punk. Okay, we'll call them emo pop punk.
They're not emo. That's not the thing. Fool, get out of here.
Oh, I love this reaction.
It's because it's just factually incorrect. That's what's... I mean, yes, I enjoy Offspring as well, but they're definitely not emo.
They're not an emo band. I just want to see. I just want to keep saying.
Like, you're just trying to hurt me tonight. Why?
Daggers, baby. Daggers.
Fuck. Yeah, we...
Okay. Outside of punk, what other genres do you enjoy listening to?
Like the rock genre.
Just solely the rock genre.
For the most part, yeah.
Nothing else.
Not really.
Okay.
Like, I mean, if other stuff is on, like, I'll listen to it, right? So,
mm-hmm. And just out of the appreciation of music, you'll...
Yeah. Like, there's certain rock, like, you know, like heavy metal or mm-hmm. like death metal. I guess more specifically like death metal mm-hmm. or like black metal and stuff. Like, I don't really like that music all that much, and I will likely turn that off. But I can appreciate the musicality of it, because it's a little too much for me. I'm not really interested in listening to like Meshuggah or something.
Satan.
Though I will say, like black metal and like death metal bands, their names are amazing, and the album work is even amazinger, and the song names are like the best. It's the amazingness, like. I love just looking at it and be like, what am I going to get myself into? And it's
you just pick the most ridiculous.
It's
name
like cannibalistic
on
evisceration. And I'm like, all right, wonder what this song's about.
It's about kitty cats.
Yeah. like hip hop, R&B, like I can get, I don't mind it. Like I don't dislike it in any way. Mm-hmm. You know, there's definitely a lot of stuff that I do enjoy for sure.
Yeah.
Then same, like, you know, we already talked about kind of cover like the electronic music.
Mm-hmm.
And then country, I'm not a huge fan of. I think in all honesty, I think country genre is the least progressed music.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the sense of it's like ideals, but I feel like it has like actively tried to stay steadfast. There's tried to be steadfast in staying the same.
Yeah. It's not creative.
It's not evolving.
Yeah.
At least from my very ignorant ears. And then what other genres are there? I mean, I will be a little more proactive in listening to like, I do enjoy like jazz and blues. Mm.
I love big band jazz. I love big band jazz.
Yeah. That's good. I like that. I like that style. Yeah. For sure. Like, and that kind of in the, all of that, if I'm feeling adventurous, I'll get into some more of the like interesting jazz. Mm-hmm. You know, think of like more aggressive stuff that has, I guess more of like the, like more nuanced. I don't know the words to use to describe it, but like just kind of like the weirder jazz is like the best way I can use to describe it. Right. Where it's like really weird time signatures.
Yeah.
Where like, you know, the drummer and like the bassist or whoever, like the pianist are like, they're off tempo, but also on tempo at the same time. Yeah. It's very weird and kind of like disorienting.
Right. God, who does
that? You say like Coltrane or something like that. It's kind of like the,
is it the Coltrane band that does that? Well, yeah, I think you're right. I think you're right, because I don't think. Well, I mean, they all may have sampled with it, but like the Duke Ellington band is pretty on tempo.
I'm not 100% sure. I know who that is, but it's fine.
It's another big brass band or big band. Pop crooner, like Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin.
No. I'm cool with not listening to that.
I grew up with my grandfather. He loved that shit. So, like, all that's ingrained in my head. Anytime it comes on, I'm like, oh, yeah, I got that.
It just doesn't do anything for me.
Yeah.
That, like, that oldies, or not oldies, but, like, you know, the music, like, I would say, like, pre-70s, pre-60s, mm-hmm. more so. I'm kind of, like,
The 20s through 50s?
Yeah, I'm like, that's a genre of like, I'm cool not listening to like Elvis and stuff like early Elvis. Like,
yeah.
No thanks. Not a fan.
Yeah. I'm not a big fan of Elvis.
That's barely our parents' generation music. Yeah. Like, you know, because there's an argument to be made that like a lot of our musical taste is developed kind of through our parents, because that's what we grow up listening to.
Yeah.
I also had I was fortunate enough to also have like an older brother who like at a younger age introduced me to like Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Mm-hmm. Hell yeah.
And questionably Dave Matthews Band. But you know, that like introduced me to like more mainstream music. Cause otherwise like I was listening to a lot of like 80s rock,
mm-hmm.
which I thoroughly enjoy.
Right. Yeah, I love 80s rock too. That's what I grew up with.
Yeah, same, right? And we grew up with that because that's what our parents listened to.
Kansas, Boston, Eagles, right. Journey.
So it's gonna be real weird with like people having kids today, and they're like, man, I just really love some of the oldies, you know, like Tekashi 6ix9ine.
Oh man!
And we're gonna have kids like that. They're like,
there are already kids like that, like early Usher or. He's just like, oh yeah, like,
Let It Burn, baby.
Oh man, but they're just like, oh yeah, those oldies, and I'm like, what the fuck did you just say? Like,
I mean,
but I get it.
Who are you talking to? Because
it's overhearing these conversations.
Because I work with high schoolers, and they've never referenced it as oldies. Responding to
my two little fuckers at the previous gym that I was doing CrossFit football with, those little fuckers. They're like, oh,
they're probably just trying to hurt you.
I think they were, because they were like, oh yeah, Usher's oldies, isn't he? I was like, I'll fucking kill you. I'll fucking kill you.
one of the kids, he's a senior, right? And you know, can be an asshole. And he'll throw stuff out there, and he's like, he'll throw stuff out there, like trying to like make me old.
Yeah.
I was like, bro, I'm not that old. Yeah. I'm like, how old do you think I am? He's like, I don't know. I'm like, okay, calm down.
Yeah. There's like stations like. If you fly and you listen to the radio that they provide, right, you can put on the oldies station. All the oldies are from the 90s now.
Yeah.
I'm just like, oh, that hurts.
I mean, I'm cool with that. I don't listen to a lot of music from the 90s other than like Spice Girls. It's kind of like largely where it stops for me.
NSYNC or Backstreet Boys?
You know, I don't have a favorite.
Okay.
I like both of them equally. But... we all know that it was New Kids on the Block, so it's fine. Can't forget them.
Oh my God.
NKOTB.
A lot of people forgot that Mark Wahlberg was a wannabe rapper back in the day too.
Yeah.
Marky Mark.
Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch.
Mm-hmm. As Calvin Klein underwear.
Oh, yeah. And a couple other things during that time too, but we're not going to talk. We're not going to talk about those here. Feel free to Google that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You'll enjoy the pictures.
We might be talking about something else. We might be talking about different things.
Are we not talking about Marky Mark anymore?
We're still talking about Marky Mark, but some other things about him from that time period.
His arrest?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, we're talking about the same thing. Cool.
Yeah. We're there.
All right. Never mind. What was I going to say?
You don't like Osbourne either.
Yeah, so like 90s music, it's a lie. 90s music kind of sits in this like weird mix. So like I'm not a huge fan of grunge music for the most part, and then like that weird like turn of the century
pop
of
pop,
like
blow up.
Well, like nu metal, right? Like
who's nu metal? Who was nu metal?
Korn.
Oh, okay. I get it, yeah.
Yeah, Korn, like, and it's new with an NU in case you're curious. Right? They like, and there was this like weird like that like early 2000s was like a really weird transition period of music, because it was like not grunge, but like didn't really like, but that like 90s pop was kind of like fading out, and there's like a weird like intermingling of like genres, and then it kind of like came out the other end into like the like mid late 2000s where like normal music was happening again.
Yeah,
it was a very weird time.
Yeah, pop kind of, I mean, it didn't fall off, but it kind of took a backseat to the new era of rock
pop.
Yeah.
If anything, pop got bigger.
You think so?
Pop is definitely the dominating force of music right now.
I agree. I think it's the largest listened to, but I think it's more to which scene or setting surrounding you're part of. For me, it took a backseat to rock. Like all the new metal, the emo scene, like all of that was more dominant in my circle rather than pop music.
See, real quick, I want to find out who are some of the top new metal bands. Oh boy. Korn, Limp Bizkit.
Oh my God, Limp Bizkit, man.
I don't know if this is accurate. I just Googled it, so don't quote me on this. Put Slipknot in there, Linkin Park.
Does Slipknot?
System of a Down. Huh. I loved Mudvayne when I was a kid. Oh, Static X. Enjoyed Static X, Cold Chamber. This is pretty much the soundtrack to the first Resident Evil movie that came out. I remember buying that and like hearing like Cold Chamber for the first time. And I was like, what is happening?
Power Man 5000.
POD, Mushroom Head.
Oh, POD.
Seven Dust, Fear Factory, again, Resident Evil. El Nino, Resident Evil. Yeah, you know what? If you want to know what new metal is, go to the very first Resident Evil movie. Listen to that soundtrack. And that's literally what it is. Because I just named like... remember at least like six or seven of those bands being on that goddamn album. I listened to that thing religiously.
Jesus.
I was so into Resident Evil. God.
And
like,
now?
Way too much. I still really like Resident Evil.
Did you watch the latest one? Not the animated one, but the last one that Mia Jovovich did?
Yeah, I've watched them all.
I don't think I watched the last one.
The
last one I saw is where they ended on the boat. They're the large... cruise vessel.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I saw whatever's after that.
I'm not 100% sure. Yeah. But
it's whatever they had the flying ones that were attacking the White House. I never got to see that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, they definitely strung that out, in my opinion, a little too long.
Oh God. Yeah. Over 2 decades, no?
Pretty much. They
and they just released an animated one.
The anime one's not bad.
Is it good?
Yeah, it's worth a watch.
Okay.
It's decent.
I mean, I've seen all of them except for those two, so I might as well finish it.
It's
like watching The Fast and the Furious. If you've seen all seven, you might as well watch the last two.
You might as finish it off.
Yeah.
Yeah, this newest one is different in... It's different in the sense that it's like not quite the same with like Umbrella being like the major corporation behind it. It's... but it's like military
military testing, and you know, it's the bad government, you know, some congressman trying to do whatever to whatever. Yeah, it's an interesting one. It's worth the watch. I think if you enjoy Resident Evil, it's worth the watch. If you're not really into it in any way, shape, or form,
just skip over that.
Just skip over it because you're gonna not enjoy it really.
This is a recommendation to not watch that movie if you're not a fan.
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah,
and it's like the only thing that kept me going is I was like, I like Resident Evil, and it's like they're playing into it with like some of the characters, and I was like, I know them, and I know them. And they like loosely reference Raccoon City. So I'm like, all right, cool. Let's do it. Yeah. Sign me up. But yeah, that's about it. Otherwise, meh.
Nice.
Anything else you want to kind of throw on about Muzak?
Ryan and I are going to try and see a bunch of shows before the end of the year. If you guys are interested, or
if you're interested,
with they're interested, not you.
Oh,
if they're interested, if you guys listeners are interested, let us know what you guys want to see, or if you guys are looking forward to seeing anything. What are you looking forward to see? I know we've said a couple of them. Well, off air, we've said a couple of them.
Oh, the one that I'm excited the most about is next year, which is like Def Leppard, Poison, Motley Crue.
Five bands lineup.
I'm going to shit my pants. I am so excited. I might even do heroin just to go.
I hope they're leopard pants, leopard print pants.
Bro, I'm wearing a cowboy hat. I'm going to wear my Ed Hardy.
Get the fuck out of here.
I'm going to be pulling a Bret Michaels from Rock of Love. Like so fast.
I cannot wait to see that outfit.
Oh, it's gonna be some. I'm gonna be walking around causing people sexual tension.
Hell yes,
that's what's gonna happen.
Hell yes, I cannot wait.
Never mind. There are a couple things I don't want to talk. I don't know if I should talk about publicly. Yeah, that's probably the biggest one that I'm most excited about because I love all of those bands.
Mm-hmm. That's a good lineup right there. It's a really good lineup. That's a solid lineup.
So yeah, and then yeah, there's a couple other ones. Like there's another show, there's another show with a big punk, or not a big punk band, but like a punk band that I liked growing up that's going to be performing, that I'm very intrigued to go see. So that'll be kind of a fun one. I think it's on like a Thursday, which kind of sucks. So I'm not really excited to go out on a Thursday night,
yeah.
But I guess I'll make it happen
nice.
For the sake of this.
Yeah,
but we'll see. Honestly, with I'm also a little bit nervous about some of the shows, given that like the idea of like these big ass crowds is a little concerning to me.
Did you see the new update and announcement?
Yeah, you have to wear masks.
No, in California, any event over 1,000 people, you have to have proof of vaccination.
Yes. Yeah. I was talking to one of my clients about that, and I was like, I am very torn on that concept. Like, there's a part of me that goes like, yeah, it's probably the smart thing to do. But then there's also the part of me that's like, that I don't know if we should be having our...
Going down that very
potentially slippery slope.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how to feel about that.
Who had to walk around with ID cards?
Well, I wouldn't make that type of comparison because we all walk around with ID cards.
Well,
don't
fair.
I mean, right?
Well, most of us.
We all have, like, majority of us in the U.S. have IDs that can be requested to a certain degree. Like, we have to show proof of stuff all of the time, right? So it's not too far, like too far of a stretch, but there is a certain point where I'm just kind of like, I feel like this one feels just a little more icky to me.
It's gonna be slippery.
And so yeah, I don't have any hard comments on it. I haven't fully figured out how I feel about it because I'm a little bit in the middle.
Yeah.
So whatever. I'm vaccinated, so I guess at the end of the day, I don't really care.
Yeah, you can literally go do whatever you want.
I can still go do shit. So. Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah.
Kind of. I don't know.
For the most part.
There's like, I don't know, man. I don't know. It's weird. It's weird. I feel weird about it. And I don't know. I don't know how to feel.
Just get it tattooed on your arm.
I don't know. Just say I don't know.
I don't know.
That's pretty much it. But yeah, let us know what type of shows you want to go to.
Yeah.
That you're interested in, or are you excited for music, or what? Even more so, what's a unpopular opinion about music about a band?
Yeah.
Are you a famous band that you don't like, or a band that you like that is getting shit on.
Yeah, like Offspring.
Or Creed. I guess Nickelback in this sense. We did talk about Nickelback.
Nickelback, yeah. Hot Fuzz.
Get it to chop. All right, Eric. Anything else you want to talk about?
I jumped the gun and I said last week, this week, that we're going to have Dr. Heather on. But this upcoming week, we're going to have Dr. Heather on for the following week.
About time you fucked this up.
I know, right?
Yeah, I think it was just because I kept saying it so often.
It just got stuck,
in your head. Turned into an earworm.
God, and then you texted me, is Heather coming over? I'm like, no, that's next week, dude.
I was so excited. I was like planning it. I was like, all right, I got this. We could do this. I'm like, let's got this going.
I even had to check my phone again. I was like, wait. No, that's next week.
And it was so stupid because I have it in my calendar and I was looking at my calendar and it wasn't on the day.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what am I talking about?
Yeah.
I can see it.
Yeah.
So. Whatever. I mean, I'm stupid.
I mean, honestly, that's, again, we would love to hear what venues or genres that you're interested in, what shows you want to go to, but also because we have Dr. Heather coming up, if there's anything you want to ask as far as men's health related, please, by all means, send it to us at anotherreppodcast@gmail.com or to our Instagram at anotherreppodcast. Again, we won't share your information if you don't want us to. We won't share your information.
We just won't share it.
Yeah, we won't share your information unless you specifically ask us to.
There you go.
Yeah, that's a better way to put that.
Yep, and then you can listen to us wherever you listen to podcasts. You can also check us out on YouTube if you'd like to listen to it through YouTube. Occasionally Twitch. twitch.tv/anotherrep.
Do we even have anything on Twitch yet?
Yeah, I've streamed a couple times.
Nice.
I streamed a couple times for us like doing some research on an episode and then just playing some video games.
Hell yeah.
So yeah, we need to get you on it. So if you ever feel like streaming a video game, you can play.
I got it. So I have to link my Twitch up to my computer.
Oh, I'll give you
the login.
Yeah, our Twitch.
Yeah.
Not your own.
Is it the one without commercials? Do we have Twitch without commercials?
No.
Oh.
You're paying for that shit.
Lame.
Maybe one day. If anyone wants to sponsor us to have a paid Twitch subscription, I'd be down for that.
That'd be dope.
But then the other part, too, is you can also text us questions, too. So if you are interested in hopping on or sending a message over or leaving a voicemail, say for Heather or for us, you can reach us at 530-PODCAST. That's 530-763-2278.
Hey.
All right, bye.
Bye.